is a bulging of a part of the contents of the abdominal cavity through a weakness in the abdominal wall. We can define it in another way. It may be a protrusion of a viscous or a part of viscous through a defect in the abdominal wall musculature or a weak natural pathway in the abdominal wall. Now, anatomical causes of abdominal wall herniation. In spite of the complex design of the abdominal wall, the only natural weakness caused by inadequate muscular strength are the lumbar triangles. Over here, you can see this is the lumbar triangle. The base is formed by the iliac crest. Lateral wall is formed by the edge of the latissimus dorsi, and the anterior wall is formed by the edge of external oblique. So they are the only weaknesses. And also you can say that the posterior wall of the inguinal canal over here, this is the superficial inguinal ring, and behind this epineurosis is the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. We will discuss this posterior wall of the inguinal canal in the coming slides. Many structures pass into and out of the abdominal cavity, creating weakness which may lead to hernia. Most common example is the inguinal canal in the male, along with the testes, descend from the d along which the testis descends from the abdomen to the scrotum at the time of birth. So the spermatic cord which passes through this inguinal over here, through the inguinal canal, causes an inherent weakness in this space. 80% of all hernia repairs are for inguinal hernia. We will discuss this inguinal hernia in detail in the coming slides. Here are the landmarks in the abdomen. You can see very central is the linea alba, which is a fibrous tissue between the two right and left sides of the abdominal wall. And then it's a McBurney's incision point here, where famous appendicectomy is done midway between 2/3 medial and 1/3 lateral line joining the umbilicus to the anterior subthoracic spine. This is the McBurney's incision point. The arcuate line here, the inguinal ligament, and the linea semilunaris, which is the lateral part of the rectus sheath, the sheath in which the rectus abdominis muscle is encased. The lateral edge of that, the sheath, is called linea semilunaris. And arcuate line is where it ends here, posteriorly. So this is also a part, also a point where a type of hernia can take place. Here you can see the figure where you can see couple of bulges, and these are the hernias. And you can see first over here a bulge is a hernia of the linea alba, and then bulge in the umbilicus is the umbilical hernia. Here you can see a bulge is a hernia at the linea semilunaris. And here you can see a bulging which is labeled as incisional hernia. So these all bulges are caused by one or the other type of hernia. And here you can see actually how it shows up in a patient. What are the causes of hernia? Weakness due to structures entering and leaving the abdomen. We all know that. Then the second cause may be the developmental failure. for example, in case of umbilical hernia, at the time of birth, the abdominal organs fail to descend within the abdominal cavity, so they remain inside in the umbilical area, causing umbilical hernia. Genetic weaknesses of collagen fiber. As you know that the collagen is a component of connective tissue, and they give a lot of strength to the tissue. If the collagen for one reason or the other is weak genetically, then there is a high chance that the patient develop one or another type of hernia in his lifetime. Then sharp or blunt trauma to the abdominal wall, obviously that can cause weakness due to aging. Nerve injuries to the abdominal wall, for example, a patient who has underwent an appendicectomy, and in the incision the inguinal nerve injures, which leads to inguinal hernia later on in the life. And the last part is excessive intra-abdominal pressure for various reasons. For example, in chronic liver disease and ascites creates in excessive intra-abdominal pressure, which may lead to umbilical hernia formation. Now, the common principles in the abdominal hernia. An abdominal wall hernia has two essential components: a defect in the wall, obviously we know that there should be a defect, and its contents, that is the tissue that has been forced out through the defect. The weakness may entirely be in muscle, such as in incisional hernia, or maybe in the fascia, which is an example is epigastric hernia through linea alba, or through the bony component in femoral hernia. The content of the hernia may be tissue from extraperitoneal space alone, for example, as in epigastric hernia, or it could be urinary bladder in case of direct sliding direct inguinal hernia. The term sac of peritoneum is that the peritoneal, when the defect takes place in the abdominal wall, the internal organ pushes the peritoneum out into the through that defect, and it may allow the bowel and the omentum to pass through the defect. Hernia are usually obvious, so therefore these hernia can be classified according to its clinical features, how they appear to the patient or to the doctor. The first of all, there is a term called occult. Occult hernia is not detectable. It's so small that it is not detectable, but it causes severe pain, and that pain is the reason why the patient seeks medical advice. Then hernia are reducible. A swelling which appears and disappears. They may be irreducible, or they may be strangulated, which means a painful swelling with a vascular compromise, and that could lead to infarction, when the contents become gangrenous, and it leads to a high mortality. The hernias could be obstructed, where in the signs of intestinal obstruction are there. It could be incarcerated, is a term where irreducible non-obstructed hernia is there for a long time. There is a term called Richter's hernia, where only part of the bowel circumference enters the hernia. Bowel obstruction may not be present, but bowel may strangulate. So this is a rare condition where part of the bowel has entered into the hernia sac, and it could be obstructed. Could be strangulated and leads to perforation. An interstitial hernia is a term where the hernia extend or pass between the layers of the abdominal wall and not directly through them. As we know that the abdominal wall is composed of layers of three muscles, the transversus, the internal oblique, and the external oblique. When a hernial content enters into between the two layers, that is called Spigelian hernia. And here you can see in the lateral part of the abdominal wall, a bulging is there, and this is between the two layers of the abdominal muscles. The clinical history and the diagnosis. Patients are usually aware of a lump under the skin, and therefore the self-diagnosis is a commonly there. As you can see, in case of a paraumbilical hernia, a swelling is always there. How do we examine a patient with hernia? A patient should be examined lying down flat initially and then standing, as this will usually increase the hernia size and become more obvious. In some cases, no hernia will be apparent with a patient lying flat. The patient is then asked to cuff, and this causes a visible cuff impulse. In cases where neck is tight and the hernia is irreducible, there may not be a cuff impulse, and it could be mistaken for a lymph node. When you notice, examine overlying skin, it is usually normal unless there is a sign of inflammation present. So, while examining a hernia, what is the checklist? What is the checklist of various points we have to observe? We have to observe the reducibility, the cuff impulse, whether there is tenderness present or not, overlying color of the overlying skin, whether the hernia has multiple defects, whether there are signs of previous surgery, or in case of inguinal hernia, scrotal contents of the hernia should be noticed, and also any other associated pathology. Since the hernia is clinically diagnosable, though not many investigations are to be done. But when we list the investigations, one or more of these investigations could be done in different cases. First of all, the plain X-ray, although it is of little value. Ultrasound scan, it is low cost, non-invasive, and gives you information about the hernial, the defect and the contents. CT scan in complex incisional hernia is a very good investigation. MRI similarly can be done in certain special cases, or contrast radiology in absence of CT scan. But CT scan is nowadays quite common, so that is the investigation of choice in case of complex hernias. Laparoscopy rarely can be done, where you pass a camera in the abdominal wall and see the abdomen from within through a camera and a monitor. Generally speaking, the management principles are as follows. Not all hernias require surgical repair. That is the foremost point, that not all hernias require surgical repair. Small hernias can be more dangerous than large hernias. Why? Because the neck of the defect is so small and the neck of the hernia is small, so there is greater chance of hernia getting obstructed or strangulated. Pain and tenderness and skin color changes make high risk of strangulation and should be repaired urgently. In case of femoral hernia, it should always be repaired because The femoral hernia is present in such a place where it is commonly missed, and it can, because of the bony component of the defect, bony component of the defect and the sharp edges of the ligaments which are in surrounding the boundary of the femoral hernia, there is a high chance of strangulation. So femoral hernia, whenever is there, should be operated. In generally speaking, operative approaches to hernia are: all surgical repair follow same basic principles. Number one, reduction of the hernial content into the abdominal cavity and removal of any non-viable tissue and bowel repair if necessary. Number two, excision and closure of the peritoneal sac if present, or replacing it deep to the muscles. Obviously, the peritoneal sac is very redundant, and you should be excised and repaired, or should be replaced deep into the muscles. It may not appear again. Reapproximation of the walls at the defect of the hernia, and permanent reinforcement of the abdominal wall defect with either non-absorbable sutures or a mesh-like structure. We'll discuss the mesh in some detail in the coming slides. Now, what is the role of a mesh in a hernia repair? The term mesh refers to prosthetic material, either a net or a flat sheet, which is used to strengthen a hernia repair. Mesh can be used to bridge a defect. It is simply fixed over a defect as a tension-free patch, or to plug a defect. A plug is made of a mesh and is pushed into the defect and attached with the help of sutures. A well-placed mesh should have good overlap around the margins of the defect, at least 2 to 5 centimeters. Although the plugs are fast to perform, but it can lead to meshoma, an inflammatory condition where the mesh becomes infected and inflamed and form a swelling. Other complications of the mesh may be the migration. Mesh is migrated to a place which is different from the where it is intended. Erosion into the adjacent organs is sometimes noted. Fistula formation, or it is a source of chronic pain. There are various types of meshes around nowadays. Majority of them are synthetic. The most commonly used meshes are either of a material called polypropylene or polyester or polytetrafluoroethylene, PTFE. So all these materials are synthetic and durable, and they are commonly used nowadays. This is how a polypropylene mesh is fixed to a tissue and to cover the hernial defect. You can see a porous structure, and these pores encourage the tissue to grow into it and make a good fibrosis within the mesh and get the strength. This is a polyester mesh. Similarly, it is placed over the defect. This is polyester, another synthetic material, and this material is braided, and it aids in the hydrophilic property. Now, talking about the mesh, now we can come to a condition which is not hernia, but it causes a bulging in the abdominal cavity, and it is not categorized, as I have already told you, not categorized as a hernia. It is nothing but a attenuated stretched linea alba above the umbilicus, usually which bulges out with any rise in the intra-abdominal pressure like coughing or sneezing. It is common in multiparous females where female underwent multiple pregnancies and multiple times the abdomen got distended. So this leads to stretching of the linea alba and divarication of the recti. You can see here in the picture, there is a bulge above the umbilicus, a longitudinal bulge, and this is because of this overstretching of the linea alba for one reason or the other. The treatment is usually conservative by abdominal binders for cosmetic reasons, because there is no chance of strangulation obstruction in such cases. Sometimes surgery is performed by augmentation of the linea alba. So now, ventral hernias, this is a broad term, and this term refers to hernias of the interior abdominal wall in true sense. Inguinal femoral hernias are not included, even though they are ventral hernias. Obviously, they are coming out from the ventral abdominal wall. Lumbar hernias are included. Lumbar hernia is included despite being dorsolateral. We will discuss all these hernias. I have willfully omitted femoral hernia because this is a specialized hernia and has to be discussed separately, although I have included inguinal hernia in this presentation. So let's enumerate ventral hernias. They are umbilical and paraumbilical, epigastric.